Good morning. How are y'all this morning? Good. Okay, I'm here with your announcements. Imagine that. All right, first up, we have Wednesday night meals and classes. If you've not started coming back on Wednesdays, please join us this Wednesday. If you would like to eat dinner with us Wednesday, you have to make reservations, and we're going to have country fried steak, mashed potatoes, green beans, biscuits, and an apple turnover. So if you would like to come, please make sure that you make your reservations for your family by tomorrow at 12. Okay, Bethel Kids and BYG parents, if you have not already, please register your child for our Wednesday night classes that can be found on the what? The Church Center app. Okay, our next announcement, I love, love, love this one. This is going to be so sweet. We're going to have a Grandparents' Day breakfast. That will be Sunday, September 8th at 9 a.m. It is for all grandparents and all grandchildren. So let's flood that kids' room that morning with grandparents and grandkids. Guess what? You have to sign up for that on the church app. Yay! Let's just make this a cool thing. When I do like that, you just say church app, okay? All right, so church app, sign up for Grandparents' Day. And there's probably going to be a really cool backdrop there. And I'll probably be there with my camera in your face, you know? Okay. All right. We have a special guest, but first, we're going to play a video of Operation Christmas Child.
Children open their boxes, you can hear the laughter, the cheer.
Jesus said, let the little children come to me. I want the children to know that Jesus Christ is alive and he'll come into each and every heart that invites him.
The mission of Operation Christmas Child is to share the gospel with children around the world.
Because we bring gift to the children, the mothers and the fathers accepted the Lord Jesus Christ.
This boxes gives us a chance to show them that there is a light, there is a truth.
Millions of children around the world are being impacted by these simple shoebox gifts. So we need to keep packing those boxes and continue to pray for the children around the world as we begin to disciple them. God bless you. Thank you.
Good morning. We are so excited to announce the kickoff of our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. We have many ways you can contribute to this wonderful ministry. You can go the traditional route and pack your own box. The red and green logo boxes are in the front foyer ready for you to grab and pack. If you visit our church website or church app, there's an Operation Christmas Child section with an Amazon wish list. The wish list has many great items you can purchase in bulk that are OCC approved. When you purchase these items, you can have them shipped to the church. We're hoping this will make contributing to this ministry much more convenient. With these items, we'll be having a packing party for the October Women of Hope meeting. Please have all items packed in shoeboxes to the church by October 6th. We would greatly appreciate your support in this ministry, and we know it will make an impact on so many lives in the kingdom of God. Okay, please stand and worship with us.
All right, good morning, y'all. Let's worship.
Ooh.
of what the mercy of God can do. If you knew me then, you believe me now. He turned my whole life upside down. He took the old and he made it new. That's just what the mercy of God can do. Now I'm alive to tell the story, how I've overcome. It's His goodness and mercy and the power of His blood. I'm so glad that my freedom wasn't based on what I've done, but the goodness and mercy and the power of it's His goodness and mercy and the power of the blood. you conquered death. But that is not an enemy that we have to face as long as we have you. Lord, I pray for Tracy. Lord, I ask that you just speak through him. Let him just be a vessel. And Lord, I just pray that you open our ears and open our hearts to what you have for us today. In your precious name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. How are you doing today? Is there any place on this planet that you would rather be than in church, in God's house? I can't think of one. For the last several weeks, Pastor Harley has done an amazing job at laying out and walking us through seasons. He talked to us about how our spiritual lives mimic the seasons, the seasonal changes that we'll go through. He talked about summer being a change season for growth, right? He talked about fall being a season of change. This past week, he talked about the spiritual winters and how harsh life can be, changes can be on us. I always appreciate the ability to be able to share God's word with people, but I appreciate this one even more because he saved the best season for last. He allowed me to speak to you about spring. Spring brings about this refreshing of the earth, doesn't it? For anyone that does not believe in God, how can they look at the earth during the springtime and not believe in God? The earth goes dormant. And all of a sudden, things start to come alive again, don't they? A survey was done and they asked random people what come to mind when they thought about spring. They said things like fresh cut grass. Things like blooming flowers and chirping birds, longer days, right? When I think of spring, I think of new beginnings. I think of fresh starts, of new life, of celebration. I feel energized and ready to witness the beauty of the rebirth of our earth. Ready to start over, ready to inhale fresh air, right? Ready to get outside. Ready to open up the windows and let that stale winter air out and the fresh spring air into your home. Now that I have all of you energized and thinking about turkey hunting, can I get you to stand up for the reading of God's word? Today we'll be reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, verses 16 through 21. Isaiah 43, 16 through 21. And while you're getting there, I want to remind you that the faith and the hope of God's people at this time was at an all-time low. They were in captivity in Babylon. So much so, in fact, that they constantly needed assurance that things would eventually turn around for them, that God would eventually do all the things that he said he was going to do. Throughout the book of Isaiah, we read these assurances. They're repeated over and over again. They're done in different word pictures to kind of help the children understand what God was talking about. Listen to what God tells them through the prophet Isaiah. Read with me Isaiah 43, 16 through 21. This is the NLT version. He says, I am the Lord who opened up a way through the waters, making a dry path through the sea. I called forth the mighty army of Egypt with all its chariots and horses. I drew them beneath the waves and they drowned, their lives snuffed out like a smoldering candle wick. But forget all that, he said. It is nothing compared to what I'm going to do. For I am about to do something new. See, I have already begun. Do you not see it? I am making a pathway through the wilderness. I will create rivers in the dry wasteland. The wild animals in the fields will thank me, the jackals and the owls too, for giving them water in the desert. Yes, I will make rivers in the dry wasteland so my chosen people can be refreshed. I have made Israel for myself, and they will someday honor me before the whole world. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for allowing us to come together as the body of Christ and worship you in this place. Lord, we know that these seasons, this spring season, is just a metaphor for change. Lord, some of the changes that happen in our lives are eagerly awaited. We look forward to them, and then others, Lord, we just dislike them. Some changes we know about, some changes we have the ability to plan for. Others arrive uninvited, Lord. Catch us off guard. To all these changes, Lord, I ask for your perspective. We ask that you allow us to go into these changes happening in our lives with expectation, Lord, and hope, and not fear and dread. Father, please help us navigate these changes in our life with the confidence that you will be there beside us the entire time they are going on. Father, help us trust you no matter what we're going through. In Jesus' precious name I pray, amen. You may be seated. Spring is an amazing time of the year that I think we all look forward to. But our purpose this morning is not to talk about the natural aspects of the season, but the spiritual and the eternal aspects of it. In our text today, it indicated that spring is a time for renewal. And as we sit here on this beautiful Sunday morning, I believe the message God wants me to share with you is about new beginnings. Because there's a lot of us today going through new beginnings, new seasons in our lives. And if you've been a Christian very long, you understand that a new season with God is when He prepares to launch us into a new level. What I want to share with you today is just a few things that can help prepare you to allow God to bring new things into your life, to have them burst forth in your life. If we go back to the beginning of chapter 43, the Lord spoke this to His people, saying, "Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you." Slow down and listen to these words now, because there's some of you going through the waters right now. You think you're by yourself, right? You don't think God is with you. Listen to what He's saying. "When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you go through the fire, when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. For I am your God." In a lot of ways, what He's doing there for the children of Israel and for us is He's allowing us to understand that He will break the oppressor's power over us. The fact, though, is the children of Israel, and sometimes a lot of us sitting here today, have been through so many hard times that we have a hard time believing that God is there. Believing that God will do what He says He will do. Today I want to talk to you about four things found in the scripture we read this morning that will help us deal with the changes that are inevitably coming to all of our lives. If you're taking notes, the first point is this. In order for us to remember God's blessings, we have to look to the past. How many of us are like the children of Israel? How many of us have a poor memory when it comes to all the blessings and all the miracles that God has done in our lives, but we have no problem remembering all the problems we've had? You see, Isaiah knew this about his people, and he constantly reminds them of the great things that God did for their forefathers, for their ancestors, as He brought them out of Egypt. I want to say this slowly because I believe someone here not only needs to hear it, but actually needs to believe it. That same God that split the Red Sea and held back those walls and allowed the children of Israel to walk through on dry ground can most certainly handle the problems that we are going through today. He can make a way through the wilderness that you're walking through right now. Here's what we have to know, though. When we are going through these transitions, when we're going through this wilderness stage in our lives, it's probably going to hurt. We're probably going to lose things that in and of our own power, we would have never let go of. But know this, if God takes something out of your life, it's not a loss. It's just a transition. Look at what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. In this new season you're going through, there will be things that will pass away that you thought would last forever. You never imagined that you would lose these things. But I need to remind you that when you're walking with God and He takes certain things out of your life, He will also be bringing new things back into your life that will be so beautiful, so meaningful, so valuable that in time you will understand that God was always there with you. God did it for your benefit. God did it for your blessing. But let's be honest with ourselves. Our faith isn't always strong enough to bring us through that, is it? A lot of times we'll struggle with that, won't we? Oh, we know God will do some things. We know God has the power to do whatever He wants. But when it comes to these big mountains in our lives, we don't think He's paying attention. We think He can't. Or maybe we think He just won't move these mountains. That's why it's so important for us to look to the past. To remember, folks, this isn't the first mountain God has had to move in your life. We have to remember that our God is fully capable of handling the big problems that we're going through as much as He is the little problems. Do you believe that God's word is true? Because if you do, you know that He tells us that He knows how to handle our problems. Look at Psalms 46:1 with me. It says, God is our refuge and our strength. He is always ready to help in times of trouble. Psalms 34:17 says, the Lord hears His people when they call to Him for help. He hears you. He hears me. He rescues us from all our troubles. Look at Isaiah 41:10. It says, do not be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, because I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold you up with my righteous right hand. Do you believe all of God's word, or do you just believe parts of it? Do you believe God's word applies to you, or do you believe it just applies to somebody else? Because if you believe all of God's word, then you know He is always there, He's always listening, and He will never stop loving you. Think about some of the things you faced in your life. Things you thought you would never get through. At that time, these were your Egypt. This was your Babylon. Did God not make good on His promises then, though? God will always make good on His promises. God cannot break His promises to you. There are two ways that we filter things as human beings, though. We either filter them through our own capabilities. I'll never get through this. I can't handle this. I don't know what to do. We filter it through our own filters, or we filter it through God's promises. You see, we see the facts and we conclude that we can't do it. The whole time God is saying, through me, you can do this. We think it's impossible. What does God say? All things are possible. We think we're too tired. Jesus said, take my yoke. I will give you rest. We think we're worried and frustrated. We feel all alone. God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Cast all your cares upon me. Do you believe God's word is true? Because if you do, you have to believe those promises. When we don't believe, we end up like Israel, missing out on some blessings. Do you remember the 12 spies that went out? 10 of them came back and said, oh no, the grapes are too big. We'll never be able to carry them. The giants are too big. They'll slay us. They'll wipe us out. Because of their unbelief, there were two people from that generation, adults, that got to go into the promised land. Joshua and Caleb were the only two. Hundreds of thousands of people did not get to enjoy the milk and honey because they didn't believe. So let me ask you a question. When you walked into here today, are you doubting God's word? Are you doubting the promises that God gave you? Is there some area in your life where your thoughts, your doubts, are in contradiction to God's promises? Because if there are, this message is for you. Because you need to change your way of thinking. So we have to look to our past to remember the blessings. The second thing we have to do to allow the changes of God to happen in our life is you have to stop dwelling on the past. Now I know that may sound just a little bit contradictory. But bear with me just a second, and I'll try to clear it up. Have you ever noticed how quickly we forget the blessings and how long we hold on to the hurt? Isaiah is telling his people, look back to all that God has done for your people, but don't dwell on the past. Do you know people who can't live in the blessings of today because they're so busy living in the good old days and remembering what happened in the good old days? Can I ask you a question? Why did they call it the good old days? We had no AC. We had no phones. We had this giant bag phone that was $900 a minute. We had no internet, so we couldn't watch Colby growing tomatoes. We had no indoor plumbing. We had no Facebook, no Instagram to post what we had for supper last night. Why was it called the good old days? I'm struggling with that. Those good old days, whether good or bad, are so vivid in people's minds that they can't live in today because they're too busy living in the past. If you get stuck in the past, you're going to have difficulty seeing the new things that God is trying to do for you today. Some of you aren't going to want to hear this, but it's time to stop living in the past and let go of those things that are hindering your future with God. There comes a time when we have to stop dwelling in the past and start looking ahead for the new miracles that God wants to do in your life because they are most assuredly going to overshadow the old ones. In the Message version, you won't often hear me read from the Message, but in the Message version, Isaiah 43:18 reads like this. Forget about what's happening. Don't keep going over old history. Be alert. Be present. God says this, I'm about to do something new in your life, brand new. It's bursting out. Do you not see it? The versions, other versions say, do you not perceive it? Do you not understand what I'm doing? You see, he's not telling us to forget the past. He's not telling us to forget the former mistakes that we've made. Remembering is useful. Remembering allows you to understand how God brought you out of Babylon, but it also helps you make better decisions in the future. He's saying don't dwell in the past, so much so that you can't think of anything in the future. He's telling us not to spend so much time there that we can't see how God is working in our lives right now. Can I share some truth with you? Sometimes when you live in the past, when you dwell in the past, when you can't get over things that have happened to you past in your past, that is Satan keeping you in bondage. Satan is holding you back. God is saying to you today, I want to do a new thing in your life. I am wanting to spring forth now. Not tomorrow, not next year. I want to do it now. Can you not see it? I want you to understand today that these things that you have deemed impossible barriers in your life are not a problem for our God. Please don't make our God smaller than your problem. Do you truly think that the God who had the power to put rivers in a barren desert cannot handle our problem? Newsflash. Not only can he, but he wants to, and he will if you'll give them to him. The next thing we have to do is to move forward. Move on to new things. Verse 19 in the NIV version says, see, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Isaiah wants the people to realize that spring is ready to burst forth in their lives. That hard winter that Harley described to us last week, it's over. He's saying to them that God is doing a new thing right now. It's springing up in your life right now. God wants us to look ahead. It's time for us as Christians to declare that spring is here. And the answers to your prayers are beginning to happen now. How many of you have prayed so long about something that you've just about given up on it? Prayed so long and haven't seen any answers to your prayers. You might be discouraged. You might be giving up hope. That's what Isaiah is dealing with. But I need you to understand that spring is here now. In Mark 4, 26 through 28, I'm not going to read it to you. You can see it behind me. Jesus gives us a picture of how things grow in the natural realm. The parable of the growing seed tells us that the seed is planted in the ground. It sprouts. It grows, though he does not know how. You see, we don't see it happening, but the soil is producing grain. It says, first the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel comes. Your prayers are just like this. Things are happening when you are praying, although you can't see them and you don't understand how things are happening when you pray. Don't stop praying. I am standing here in front of you now because somebody would not stop praying for me. The spring of the year brings the rebirth of the earth. New beginnings. This plant called a crocus breaks through the ground with these giant purple blooms. These bright yellow daffodils open up with this blast of color. The dogwoods begin to bloom. The redbuds begin to bloom. Birds begin to sing again. Your spiritual life renews in much the same way. Isaiah asked them, and I'm asking you now, can you not see God moving in your life? God is telling us to stop dwelling on the things in the past that's weighing us down, that's binding us, that's stopping us from looking ahead. Because when you do, you can begin to be more open and more perceptive. You'll begin to recognize what God is doing in your life. When you do that, you actually begin to expect new miracles in your life. You actually get a positive outlook on life. The fourth and final thing that I want to share with you is probably one of the hardest things I've ever had to learn to do, and I'm still not very good at it. You have to patiently wait for God. Patiently wait for God. You see, folks, God moves in His own time. God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. When we look back on the year that has passed, we should praise God for His presence in our lives, for the providing the daily bread that He's provided for us. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that I serve a God that is a nick of time God, not a tomorrow God. When I'm down and out, I'm glad to know that God is there and will not wait until tomorrow to lift me back up. When I'm racked with pain and my neck and back is killing me so bad, I am glad that I serve a God that won't wait until tomorrow to soothe my aching pain and heal me. I'm glad that we don't serve a God that'll wait until tomorrow to hear or answer our prayers. Aren't you? When we are weak, God doesn't wait to turn our weaknesses into strength. When we are defeated, He doesn't wait to turn those defeats into victory. When you get down and discouraged, God doesn't wait to start turning that discouragement into hope, does He? In the year ahead, I want you to walk out of here with the confidence of knowing that the God you serve will not let you down. He'll do whatever He needs to do to get it done. And He'll do it right on time. He won't wait until tomorrow, but I want you to understand, in the fullness of time, God's time might feel like an eternity to us, and very often does. But what He has for you, what He has for us, will always find its way. If I can get the praise team to come up now, I'm going to end with this. If you walked in here today doubting God, if you walked in here doubting His love for you, doubting His ability to move those mountains for you that you've been dealing with for what probably seems like eternity, I want you to come down to this altar. If you remember, the man that asked Jesus to heal his child said, "I have faith, but Lord, please help my faith." Every one of you here has faith, but every one of you here could use a strengthening of that faith. My ask is for you to come down to this altar and pray to God to increase that faith. I want you to walk out of here having the faith to know that God has all the answers that you've been looking for. But I need you to know this, you won't find those answers on your own. You won't find those answers in some self-help book. It's not there. Dr. Phil can't give it to you. Those faith and those answers can only be found in prayer. Pray for the faith that was secured for you by a God that loved you so much that He sent His only begotten Son to die for you on that cross. Pray for that faith that was secured for you through that cross on Calvary's hill. Pray for the faith in the redemption that was bought and paid for with those nail-scarred hands, that bowed down head. A faith that was also proven again 3 days later when that same man rose from the grave and beat death. Folks, to get through this world, we have to have a faith that assures you that you serve a God that won't wait until tomorrow to provide for you. He is a today God. And if He's not waiting, why are you? Won't you come down?